Hello everyone, Center here with another Rambler for you. And today I want to talk specifically about a concept that I call incentive systems. So I'm going to start with some definitional stuff because I think that's really important to make sure that we're talking about the same thing. And then I'm going to give some sort of examples about how an incentive system looks and works and that sort of thing. So to start with, I want to look at the dictionary definition of the word incentive. It has two definitions here that I'm seeing in the Google dictionary. The first one is a thing that motivates or encourages one to do something. The other one is a payment or concession to stimulate greater output or investment. An incentive system is a system focused on examining sort of that first one, a thing that motivates or encourages one to do something. So when I'm looking at an incentive system, what I'm talking about is some sort of structure that sort of encourages people to behave in specific ways. This comes up in all sorts of places, but the first one I'm going to examine is with video games and game design, just because that's an area where it's very raw, as it were, kind of very obvious, and it's one that game designers have to think a lot about because they're always sort of asking the question of how do we get the player to do the thing that is the most fun in the game? And it's really easy for the player to be incentivized to do something that isn't fun. So to kind of step back and explain a little bit, in games, sort of what the players are trying to do is win. So the incentive system then is, given that the players want to win, what are they incentivized to use to accomplish that? Or what are they, how are they going to approach the game when their goal is to win at the game? So you definitely want to make sure, for example, that depending upon the sort of game that you're talking about, of course. If you're talking about a competitive game, you want to try to make sure that you disincentivize cheating through whatever means you can, penalties or whatever. In an atmosphere of good gamesmanship only gets you so far, but that can help. Just that's one example of sort of wanting to incentivize against something. But there's another, in game design, more subtly important thing, which is making sure that the fun thing to do is the good thing to do. In other words, the process of winning is fun because players will, if they feel that they need to, make the game unfun in order to win. And that is when you have the incentives kind of placed in the wrong way. You want a game experience to at least be enjoyable, usually anyway, unless you're trying to go for some other thing. But that kind of gets more on the art side of games. The majority of games are made to be some sort of an engaging and enjoyable experience. And when you have that, you want to make sure that the way that you've set things up incentivizes it. So it's really important, again, to make sure that sort of the mechanics are fun. The other thing that you'll find is that players can focus on a particular goal and trying to achieve that as efficiently as possible. This is actually a large part of why I dislike experience point based, generic experience point based character progression systems. And this is something you'll probably hear me talk about more in the future as well. But this is where you have to make your character stronger. There's like a bucket called experience points, and you get enough of them and you level up. Well, typically, the most efficient thing is to, in the games where this sort of thing appears, is to find the enemies that have sort of the highest yield and then just fight those enemies over and over and over again instead of exploring all of the different things the game has to offer. And this is kind of a ploy for efficiency in order to be able to gain the thing the player wants, which is enough strength to be able to win. This can also come up, for example, if a player gets an extremely powerful or, you might say, overpowered piece of equipment, and they're like, well, if I don't use this, I'm giving myself a handicap, and I'm making it harder to win. But it's also very possible for a player that using that piece of incredibly powerful equipment makes it unfun as well, because there's no longer any challenge, and it's no longer has that same level of engagement. A practical example on sort of the efficiency side is in a lot of MMOs, this will come up, but Guild Wars 2 is specifically what I'm thinking of, just because I have experience with it. And in that game, there are the dungeons, the sort of areas that you can go and explore. And beating them will give you a sort of a currency that you can use to buy special gear. So it's a special currency. And there are different paths you can take through each dungeon. And the thing is, though, when you're... we call it farming for some reason. Like, I can go into the etymology of that some other time. But when you're constantly... when you want to accumulate this currency, you're going to pick the path that is the quickest, right? You're optimizing for time and not necessarily looking to kind of explore everything. And this kind of leaves it... it makes it hard for other players who want to play through it to explore the content. They have a hard time finding a party, a group of other players to play with, because most of the players are doing it for the rewards, not for the experience. And that leads to sort of everybody funneling down the same path. That's like the most efficient way. And you can't see my air quotes, but I'm finger quoting. The most efficient way of accumulating this currency. So that's kind of a real world video game example of this sort of thing. But this doesn't just apply to games, video games, or other types of games, although it matters significantly in those. It also applies a lot to the real world. So a good example is taxes to try to disincentivize something. So this is where what you're doing is you're incentivizing a different sort of behavior than what you're taxing, because you're making it more expensive. And financial incentives tend to be extremely powerful. So an example from around here is near where I live, is the government, the local government, placing high-ish taxes on gasoline, because they want to, push less gasoline usage. And so they make it more expensive so people can't afford to buy as much. Now, the thing that's really interesting about this sort of incentive system is when it's successful and you don't take into account that you're going to achieve your goal with this sort of incentive system, where you're incentivizing, effectively you're incentivizing people to purchase more fuel efficient vehicles. Things like hybrids, all electric cars, which just bypass gas entirely, or just the cars that are more fuel efficient, as it were, on their own. And when you do this, and they've been successful at it, they see the tax revenue go down, only they'd come to rely on that tax revenue, as the government will. And so they hit sort of an economic problem of, well, we were successful in incentivizing people to have more fuel-efficient cars, and now we don't have as much money from the gas tax. And so they're wanting to raise the gas tax, and people generally aren't happy about their taxes going up. So this is kind of a real-world example of an incentive system at work, as opposed to a digital one. But a lot of these same ideas apply. And what's really important to do is to look and see what are people being incentivized to do. And keep in mind that incentives are always in relation to what the person is wanting to accomplish. So most of the time, people are wanting to accomplish things like being healthy, having sex, having more money. It's sort of that healthy, wealthy, and laid, I guess. I don't know. Sort of trifecta. Those are really popular. So when you're looking then at what sort of decisions people are going to make, they're usually going to make the decision, for example, that's going to be best for them financially. That's hands down probably the most common thing. And so when that happens, you need to say, okay, if this is the case, what are people going to do in response to other things that are done? So a good example also is, if you want to increase taxes on corporations, you're disincentivizing the corporation to be here. You're making it more expensive. They're going to want to try to be in the place that is the cheapest for them to operate in. So they might have goodwill towards your area for political reasons or whatever, but that financial aspect, especially on a business level, finances are like the strongest incentivating factor, right? It's going to have the most incentivating power, as it were. And so if you increase corporate taxes, then the corporations are going to say, wait a minute, where is it cheapest for me to do business so I can have less of my revenue taken up in expenses? And one of the things that you look at with a lot of, in the U.S. anyway, businesses, is that another example of this sort of incentive system at work in a more subtle way is the cost per employee. Like, an employee costs more for the business than the employee's wages or salary. Right? There's also different taxes on employees. There's taxes on for things like Social Security and Medicare, Medicaid sort of stuff. There's also, and those I think get like called the payroll tax. There's also often like benefits packages. Like these things add cost per employee. So the employee has this sort of like built-in cost. And then like, particularly for a wage employee that makes money on a per hour basis, having one employee work more hours is usually cheaper than breaking those hours up among multiple employees. So businesses, because of these overheads, are incentivized to have fewer employees doing more work. It's just more efficient for them, and monetarily. And what you're looking at then is this real example, like, of how sort of the efficiency of a resource of resource usage in business pushes towards specific things. And automation is sort of the zenith of this because you cut down the overhead entirely, as well as dramatically decrease wages, because you don't need to pay robots. You just need to pay for their maintenance. So what you see here then is these systems kind of work together to push towards specific things. And this is kind of, it's really important to understand how this works, because these sorts of things are at play, like, everywhere. When you look at sort of what does an open market, as it were, incentivize businesses to do, to claim market share, because that in turn plays into how much profit they're making and how much revenue they're bringing in. But competition incentivizes, in order to gain market share, incentivizes being cheaper, like having as high of quality at a low of price point as possible. And sort of what you can find then is some companies can find a niche in, okay, we're not able to do it as cheaply as possible. This other group is bigger than us. They have sort of the bulk where they can do a lot of stuff. But we have this area where we can do a higher quality product than they're doing, and people will appreciate us for our quality, not our inexpensiveness, right? And so that's where you can have that with competition. You can kind of push these sort of factors around. But an open market incentivizes claiming and capturing 100% market share. And when you do that, you no longer have to compete, which means that now you have carte blanche to do whatever you want with your prices and your quality. You can make your quality really low and your prices really high. And if people want your product, they've got no choice. And where this particularly becomes vicious is when the consumer has no ability to say no to your product. And this is what happens, for example, to something like gasoline. This can happen to some extent, although we're getting away from that more and more. But especially healthcare is heavily impacted by this. Frankly, internet service is falling into this category. And what you see in the United States is sort of these regional monopolies. There are no incentives, right? The system to incentivize a regional monopoly to improve doesn't exist because you have no choice, right? They don't have that competition. The competition is what incentivizes the company to do better by the customer, because they're having to compete in order to claim market share, which is what the company wants to do. They have to make they have to have their product appear more favorable to customers than their competition. And this is why they're incentivized to do that, right? That's what we say, is they're incentivized to make their product as appealing to the consumer as possible. And that's because their goal is to claim as much market share as possible. And that's only done by appealing to as many customers as possible. Now, there can definitely be other goals than financial that can be at play for people. There's, for example, people, if they want to be healthy, then they're incentivized to do things that they believe will lead them to be healthy. Now, it's what are they going to do for that then? Well, maybe they're going to exercise more, eat healthier, things like that. That's going to change their behavior. And that's what incentives do, is they influence behavior. They say, okay, you want to accomplish this thing. If you want to accomplish this, then that desire to accomplish this thing incentivizes you to do this thing. And that's then what a incentive system is that sort of intersection between like what goals people want to accomplish and then what paths they have to accomplish it. So as you look around and examine the world around you, I think you're going to be able to find a lot of these at play in your own life. What do you want to accomplish? What path are you going to be able to take to do it? And as with most things, people usually pick the path of least resistance, the one that they can travel down most efficiently, most easily. And that's not always the best path for them for various reasons, but that's what they're doing. And if you find, for example, with your own self that you're like, I don't really like the path that my life is on, maybe you need to look at what's incentivizing you. Anyway, I'd love to hear feedback that you have on this topic and any other topics that you'd be interested in hearing me discuss. Take care, everyone. Bye-bye.